In this problem, we're given an explicit formula for the Fibonacci sequence. This is called Binet's formula. And just as a reminder, the Fibonacci sequence is 0, 1, 1. And then you always take the sum of the previous two terms to get the next term. So the next one would be 2, the next one would be 3, 5, 8, and so on. What we're asked to do in this problem is plug in the n's into Binet's formula and show that we get the first four terms of the Fibonacci sequence correct. And it starts out simple enough, and then the math can start to get really hairy. So let's look at f0. And when I plug in 0 for n, that makes both of these terms in the numerator equal to 1, and I get 1 minus 1 over root 5, which is 0. So no big deal on that one. Then I look at f1, and that's 1 plus root 5 over 2 minus 1 minus root 5 over 2 over root 5. So we can go ahead and move the 2 to the denominator. And I have a 1 plus root 5 minus 1 minus root 5. Distribute the negative 1, and we're going to cancel those 1s. And then I get root 5 minus negative root 5, in other words, root 5 plus root 5. And I end up with 1. So that one worked out. Next, I move to f2. And as I write this down, I'm going to go ahead and move the 2 squared into the denominator. So I can see from Binet's formula, when I plug in n equals 2, each of those terms in the numerator has a 2 squared in it. So I can move that to the denominator. That's going to give me a 4 root 5. Then in my numerator, I've got 1 plus root 5 squared minus 1 minus root 5 squared. Squaring a binomial means that you multiply it by itself, and then I use FOIL on that. So out of the first one, I get a 1. My cross terms are both root 5, so I have 2 root 5. And then root 5 times itself is the L in FOIL, and that's 5. For the second one, I get a 1 minus 2 root 5 plus a 5 over 4 root 5. And then I look at what happens when I distribute the minus sign through the second expression. And I end up with a 1 minus 1, so those are gone. I end up with a 5 minus 5, so those are gone. All that's left here is 2 root 5 minus negative 2 root 5, which gives me 4 root 5. And that's all divided by 4 root 5, so I get 1. So that one worked out. Finally, we look at the n equals 3 term. And again, I'm going to start by moving the 2 to the third power to the denominator, so that's 8 root 5. And then I have a 1 plus root 5 quantity cubed minus 1 minus root 5 quantity cubed. So if I'm going to cube a binomial, there's a couple approaches. The most efficient would be to just memorize a formula for what you get when you cube a binomial. And I think what I'll do is just quickly sketch the derivation of that and then apply it. So if I'm cubing a plus b, that means I'm taking a plus b times itself 3 times. And when I'm multiplying polynomials, I just add together every possible product containing one term from each of the polynomials. That's what happens when you repeatedly distribute. So I organize myself by collecting all the terms with the highest power of a all the way down to the lowest. And I see there's only one way to get an a cubed, so that's where I would start. And then I go to the terms that are a squared. Well, that's where I pick the a from two of the binomials and the b from the other. Well, there's 3 different ways of choosing which one that b is going to come from. So there's 3 of these terms with an a squared in them and then a b. Then I go down to the terms that have only one a in them. Well, there's 3 different ways of selecting which one you're going to pick the a from, and then you pick the b's from the other two. So I get 3 of these as well. And then there's only one way to get a b cubed. So there's my formula for cubing a binomial. When I plug into this formula, I'm going to cube this first binomial in f3, and a is going to be 1 and b is going to be root 5. So I end up with 1 cubed, or just 1, plus 3 times 1 squared times root 5. I don't need to write 1 squared, plus 3 times 1 times root 5 squared, which is just 5, plus b cubed, so root 5 to the third power, and I could write that as 5 to the 3 halves. Then I get into cubing my second binomial, and here a is 1 and b is negative 5. So I have 1. Then in my a squared term, that would give me a 3 times 1 squared times b, which is negative root 5. So this is going to be negative 3 root 5. And then I go to my ab squared term. So I have plus 3 times 1 times negative root 5 squared, which is just positive 5. And then I end with b cubed. So that's the cube of negative root 5. That's going to give me a negative result, and it will be 5 to the 3 halves. Then I start cleaning things up in the numerator. The 3 times 5 or 15 terms, those cancel. And then I have 3 root 5 minus negative 3 root 5. In other words, 3 root 5 plus 3 root 5, which is 6 root 5. And then I get a 5 to the 3 halves minus negative 5 to the 3 halves. So I end up with plus 2 times 5 to the 3 halves. Then I realize 5 to the 3 halves is just 5 root 5. And so finally in the numerator, I have 6 root 5 plus 10 root 5, which is 16 root 5, divided by 8 root 5. And I get 16 divided by 8, which is 2. So that works out. So it looks like Binet's formula is working. But it also looks like it's going to become immensely complex to compute these by hand when we start to go to larger n values. It's probably wise to put Binet's formula into a computer algebra system and just sub in the n's using a computer. If you find the math content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce dozens of new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.